That's a good crowd, and good evening, and welcome. Let me say by way of beginning that I've titled these introductory words, God's Finger Touching. There's a little white steepled church in Cottonwood County, Minnesota, Amo Lutheran Church, and it's standing out there, and you can see it for miles around. It's a bulwark against heathenism, which usually comes up from Iowa. Sits out there on the prairie, surrounding by bean and cornfields on three sides, and then a county road on the fourth side. And it's my growing up church, where Sundays I would sit between my father and my grandfather and my sisters and my mother. In this church pew we'd never paid for, but we'd somehow come to think of it as our own. It was our place, not to be shared with outsiders. After that Lutheran service, by the way, which was usually a pretty good one on sin, its many manifestations and even more varieties by old Pastor Moldy, seemed to have an unusual familiarity or insight with the topic. So we would then leave our family, hurriedly usually. My grandfather, though, would dawdle in front of an upright gravestone and chat with grandmother, who, as they say in these obituary notices, preceded him. Grandfather had an inscription chiseled on that stone. God's finger, it says, touched her, and she slept. It was a darkling thing for me when I was growing up. Didn't seem to hold much promise. And it became more so in college when I was going through my existential phase, taking pride in my alienation, which was really more of a smokescreen to meet ambivalent girls whom I hoped would take me seriously. I had, you see, high ambitions. Well, we had to do another chiseling on the gravestone when grandfather passed over on his side. God's finger touched him and he slept. It didn't take much imagination. It's less darkling these days to me, that youthful existential romantic spirit having become tepid. My mother and father are gone, a sister too, God's finger touching them and they sleep, chiseled into stone. As I said, it doesn't take much imagination. Still, when I think of all this these days, all that's past and at my age, the ambivalence is almost completely gone. And I suspect I may be at a spot where I regard those words, God's finger touching, I've come to believe those three the most lovely words in all of human history. God's finger touching. It's also very easy to memorize. It's Sistine Chapel stuff, you know, but when I spiral too much into myself and I lose a kind of control, well, trust me, with that phrase, God's finger touching, one quickly comes to know the facts well enough. It's an image, you see, suggesting a larger universe of thought, more genuine human wisdom and contemplation, and in truth, it's my preference since I have in time come to believe in visionary feeling and experience and the capacity of art to realize those things. Aids to our own moments of devotion, because the soul is not made piecemeal, but in one's own book of hours. I can believe that and still be a good Norwegian, which is a paradox, you know, good Norwegian. But if I'd been wiser 25 years ago, I might have taken that image, God's finger touching, and I might have started a magazine. And then I would have nursed it along for 25 years with hope for its capacity if I had had the gumption. 25 years, one quarter of one whole century, a lot of hope, a lot of faith and prayer and God's finger touching. A magazine, you see, an aid to reflection even, or what the hey, stirring the human recesses of spirituality and moments of duration in which the soul is ineffably touched, or what the hey again, offered a grace-given experience, imminent fruition, or just such words as that, God's finger touching. That is, if I had had the gumption. So what a thing to believe, you see. Images that provide spiritual nourishment, creative intuition, acting upon an image as if that whole belief is the heavenly part of working reason, the spiritual expressing itself in the things of sense, and quickening, if I might use that biblical word, it's a good word, quickening, with prayer quickening and God's finger touching. Now, having said that, which is likely a far remove from the introduction that Mr. Somerville asked me to deliver, an introduction, he said, which needed to be brilliant, and then having failed him again, as I have so many times, and so shamefully. Well, friends gathered here from far and near, let me just add this. The wolf is at the door. And Mr. Hasted and Mr. Wolfe, would the two of you now please join me at the lectern, because Mr. Hasted has a presentation to make, and then I'll finish.
I do want to thank the English department for allowing us to interrupt this program to conduct a little bit of business. A couple of weeks ago at Homecoming, we hosted our annual Alumni Achievement Awards banquet. There were five honorees this year, and one of those honorees was unable to attend the banquet due to some previous commitments, including a commitment to campus to be here this week, and that was Greg Wolfe. So we're very pleased to have this opportunity tonight to catch up with Greg so soon after that banquet. I'm quite certain that I was the first person at Hillsdale College to ever meet Greg Wolfe. As a young admissions counselor in the mid-1970s, and while Greg was still in high school, I visited him at his home in Plymouth, Massachusetts. At that time, he was nothing more to us than a name on a card in a file, and I doubt we knew anything more about him than his SAT scores, which he had certainly had sent to us and many other colleges at that time. I was visiting high schools in the Boston area, so I had given him a call, and I explained that I was an admissions representative, and I hoped he might have a few minutes to talk to me about the college. I asked if I might meet him, fully expecting that he would reply that he wasn't really that interested in Hillsdale. But to my astonishment, he and his mother said, "Sure, why don't you come by the house tomorrow afternoon?" Now, there's something you need to understand. In those days, I could visit high schools for several days, weeks even, and never actually meet with a student. Just guidance counselors who were too polite to tell me I was wasting my time beating the bushes for prospective students in New England. Greg and his mom not only wanted to meet with me, they were letting me into their home. And that was highly unusual, and it explains, I believe, why I remember that meeting so clearly. I presented a short slideshow, as I recall, and we talked about the college at some length. And a memory of that presentation flashed through my mind earlier today. Slideshows in those days were cumbersome things with carousel projectors and slide screens and so on. And if you were really good, if you were cutting edge, you could have a cassette tape with music that synced to the slides. And I actually remembered today the music that played to that slideshow. It was a song by Judy Collins called "Who Knows Where the Time Goes." How about that? Well, apparently I did a passable job, and at least I didn't screw it up. It was much more difficult to sell Hillsdale in those days. And looking back, I can't remember. I wonder what we even talked about. But Greg applied. He had a productive 4 years here. And of course, the rest is history. He graduated in 1980, went on to have a very successful, indeed a very impressive career as a scholar, author, publisher, many of the details of which you already know. So now, nearly 40 years after our first meeting, it seems we've come full circle. When we first met in his living room all those years ago, I was hoping that Hillsdale might help Greg begin a fulfilling intellectual journey. And today he and I stand here to recognize what a fruitful journey that has turned out to be. 40 years ago, who indeed knows where the time goes? So Greg, on behalf of President Larry Arn and the Alumni Executive Committee, if I can scoot behind you here, I would like to present you with this Distinguished Alumni Award for your achievements as a writer and an educator. It's great to have you back.
Thank you so much.
So you know now that Mr. Greg Wolfe is a graduate of our college, and all of you have still big hopes. Who could have predicted from such inauspicious beginnings, such auspicious consequences? Except to say what anyone might say with inspiration, commitment, gumption, and tremendous discipline, well, what he has accomplished is a true marvel, a testament to the nourishing image of grace in all our lives, God's finger touching. So set, I'm very pleased at this time in my own life to reintroduce Mr. Greg Wolfe to his college because she has missed him dearly. And the time has been too long. It's been just way, way too long. And if you please now, all of you now, would you please stand, every single one of you? And would you please give one our own the very, very warmest of welcomes.
So this is what I get for loaning my iPad to my 18-year-old son. I get it back, and I think this is pretty much a good sign. I'm not entirely sure. I get it back, and the screen background said, "Kindness, it doesn't cost a damn thing. Sprinkle that shit everywhere." I think I'm doing something right. Are we doing something right? You know, I didn't have the heart to tell him that sometimes kindness actually costs a little bit, you know? But hey, I feel like he's halfway there right now, you know? I'm going to speak very quickly tonight because to adapt the words of the wonderful Over the Rhine song we heard last night, all I want to tell you is everything. But to help keep me in line, I'm going to put my phone here with the stopwatch on it. And I've also placed a very small explosive device in here. It will not harm you. It'll simply knock me unconscious. And it will allow you to go on with your evening. Start. Oh, my God. Okay. I want to thank John Somerville for his graciousness in putting all this together. I know you weren't alone, but you were the guy to pull it all together. And I'm so grateful to you. I'm also grateful to President Arn and all those with budget lines for putting the last 2 days together, the sort of event that you've put together that's been so gracious and so beautiful and such a warm welcome home. I'm also grateful to Andrew Hudgens and Aaron McGraw, Linford Detweiler and Karen Bernquist, my wife Suzanne, for being part of this experience. Wow. You know, the thing that makes me happiest in life is sharing the talent of wonderfully gifted artists with others. And so that, John, was a beautiful touch to this whole event. So thank you. By the way, I want to state that while it is true that I went on from Hillsdale to the University of Oxford, I can truly say that I went on to complete my PhD in not being a complete dweeb through the University of Suzanne. So thank you, sweetheart, for coming and for being here with us. It's good to be back after 34 years, Gregor. I know it was a little longer than that, 38 total after you add in the 4 years, but don't say 40 yet, man. I'm holding back as long as I can. There are mostly new faces here, but I'm also deeply appreciative of being able to see some very old and very, very dear faces that are very dear to me. I came to Hillsdale for one reason only, and that was because of my father, Charles Hull Wolfe. because he urged me to do so. To be honest, and Gregor's presentation, I'm sure, was fantastic, but basically I was more or less clueless at that point. I was thinking Boston College, Boston University, or whatever. It was my father who kept after me, who said it was an interesting place that had undergone a tremendous change and exciting and amazing things were happening. He painted an appealing enough picture so that I was willing to make the trek to this unknown world called the Midwest and to pass 4 years in this company. I mention this because my father passed away 3 weeks ago at the ripe old age of 95. And I want to dedicate this talk to his memory. He was a lifelong admirer of Hillsdale and worked tirelessly through a variety of nonprofit organizations, beginning with the Foundation for Economic Education in the mid-1950s, to educate for liberty. This one's for you, Dad. Now, a lot has changed here, of course. All this building, wow. It's great to see an institution flourishing in so many ways, but I'm glad that at least a few things have stayed the same. For example, the Dow Center. I mean, no disrespect, but this isn't going to win any architectural awards, this space. But this is pretty much tantamount, this actual space, A and B, is pretty much tantamount to sacred ground for me. This is the place when, in my freshman year, I went to my first CCA. And that first CCA, which was about imagination and literature, starred, among others, the great Southern agrarian writer, fiction writer, editor of the Sewanee Review, Mr. Andrew Lytle. It also starred Cleanth Brooks, one of the most eminent of the new critics and a hero of mine for many decades now. Thomas Howard, Clyde Kilby, I'm forgetting the rest. Those four were enough to blow my mind. That's when I became a little less clueless and a little bit more driven. And I think over the years of all the people who've stood at this podium, and I'll tell you, it's pretty intimidating. I mean, at this podium have been people including the great Orthodox theologian Alexander Schmemann, the personal confessor to Solzhenitsyn, and the great German philosopher Erich Fögelin, the guy who talked about immanentizing the eschaton. Anyway, it was a joke back in the 70s. So to be here is a little intimidating, but it also is tantamount to a sacred place for me. Back in the 1970s, when I was a student, back in the late 1970s, when I was a student at Hillsdale, Hillsdale was really just beginning to be Hillsdale. And there was really only the first signs of the transition. The CCA program, which was relatively new, there'd only been time to hire a few professors, including one of my dearest favorite professors, Dr. John Wilson, who became the chair of the history department. So at the time, for me, part of the joy of being here was glomming on to the distinguished visiting professors who were then coming here. And I was lucky. There were giants in those days. And I'm willing to be a little nostalgic about it because Dr. Gerhard Niemeyer and Dr. Russell Kirk were professors during those years. And I more or less took every class that they offered. I minored in Kirk and Niemeyer because I knew that it was a rare opportunity to be with such distinguished scholars. And truly, in an old-fashioned word that I've always loved and always wished to emulate, they were men of letters. And that's a phrase that's gone out of circulation, but it was my dearest desire in life to try to live up in some way to that phrase, man of letters. Niemeyer was intense. Those who knew him, of course, knew he was a German thinker of great rigor. And we used to joke that his most common word was Runge. Runge. That's not really fair. He was tough. He was intense. He was demanding. I remember trying to impress him in my freshman year. I actually, in a paper on Plato, I went and stole a look at Eric Vogelin's book on Plato, which was basically like kind of cheating and not really doing the assignment, which was really just read Plato and talk about Plato. But I went to get the crib sheet from the great philosopher who I knew had influenced him, and I got a C- on the paper, mostly for my presumption. I didn't do the assignment. But when Niemeyer felt that you'd done the work and you had done the work and you'd responded and engaged the material, that intense little man, that smile, was radiant. It was a ray of sunshine and a beautiful thing and something I'll never forget. Well, you've probably heard a million things about Russell Kirk over the years. You know, kowtow, great Russell Kirk. He's a cliche, he was an amazing human being in many ways. I was trying to say last night to some of the students, he was a very dear man. You know, he was a big man in the sense that he was the founder of modern American conservatism, all that stuff, but he was a dear soul. He was introverted and eccentric, but he was also a man of great love and great shyness and great affection that he found difficult to express, but many people knew and experienced, and I was one of the beneficiaries of that. One of my happiest memories of my Hillsdale years was essentially being his chauffeur for a year or two. But being Russell Kirk's chauffeur and driving him the multiple hours up to the center of the state in Macosta, where he lives, was an education, because he knew every place to stop along the way, every small town. He knew that there was a dinner theater in Homer, and he knew that there was an ice cream shop in Charlotte, and he knew that there was a great book sale at the library at Olivet, and he knew that there were great pies to be bought and cider at the orchard in Ionia. And I got to know all the back roads of Michigan with him. And in that way, he was absolutely a man who lived, who walked the talk. He was a northern agrarian who cared for the land and cared for the people, and he lived it. And that was just an amazing, I should have got credit for that. Darn it, why didn't I think about that? Now, I will admit that when I was a student, I was a little bit of a pain in the ass. Maybe by the time I'm finished this evening, you'll think I still am. I honestly hope not. I felt then, as I do now, that vigorous, even playful debate is much healthier than attempting to present a monolithic face to the world. If we have learned one thing in the past half century about conservatism, it is that it consists of a cacophony of widely divergent sects. And I say, let the cacophony continue and get louder, because only good things can come of that conversation. I loved tweaking people. I wrote an editorial in my freshman year. They were going to tear down, and they did tear down, one of the Victorian buildings, just as they eventually tore down Fine Arts and Knowlton, although they did at least replace them with lookalikes. There was a building called Worthing Hall, and I was thinking, we're conservatives. We don't tear down 18th century buildings. So I wrote an editorial called, it was a thinly veiled allegory, we must not tear down the Worthy Hall of Freedom. And it was very snarky and amateurish and infantile, and I'm still proud that I wrote it. It got me on the administration's blacklist right away. I loved writing for the Collegian. Eventually I had a column for the Collegian. I loved editing the Tower Light. I even was crazy enough to try to start a national publication called the Hillsdale Review for young conservative writers who cared about art and culture when I was a sophomore here in college. Who knew? It went for 8 years. It was like my apprenticeship for what happened afterwards, and I wouldn't have done it if I wasn't encouraged by my education here. Also, I just want to say, if there's anyone here from campus security, I believe I can close a few cold cases. I'm just hoping that the statute of limitations has run out. I only vandalized Broadlawn, the president's house, twice. Once was, I believe, if I'm not, my memory doesn't fail me, collecting a number of pink flamingos from neighboring homes in the area and gathering them in a beautiful flock for the president to see on awaking the next morning. The other involved a certain amount of shaving cream, but only on the driveway. several buddies and I, we formed a little group. We called ourselves the Cavaliers. One of the Cavaliers is here this evening. One of my dearest friends, Dr. Paul Eby, is here, and his wife, Ruth. So I'm very glad that two of the original three Cavaliers are here this evening. And so we wrote, the Cavaliers were here on the Broadlawn driveway. We felt daring at the time. But one of my best memories of that era was of a stunt that we pulled off with the blessing of the administration. I don't know, Gregor, if you remember this or if anyone else remembers this in this room, but at the time, this was the beginning of the fight with the federal government over funding. And at the time, the federal agency was known as the Department of Health, Education, and Welfare. And so a couple of us students, a guy named Steve Mastey and myself, we decided that we were going to pull a little bit of political theater. And so we went to Kroger, and we got about 65 cardboard boxes and about 1,000 yards of duct tape. And we eventually built this thing up into, I don't know, I think it was like 20 feet tall. We put white construction paper around it, and we painted it on it so it looked like a pack of cigarettes. And it said, HEW, warning, the federal government may be hazardous to your health. We got a local TV station to come. It was the dead of winter. It was snowing all around. You should have seen Russell Kirk in his three-piece suit and cigar throwing snowballs at this big pack of cigarettes. And then, to top it all off, believe this or not, I mean, talk about code violations, we burnt the thing to the ground. Those were the days, man. You could do stuff. You know, you didn't have to worry about liability laws and all of that. Hell, I went to Dr. Robert Rice's office and I smoked cheroots in his office. We talked about Dostoevsky and smoked stogies. Those were the days. I remember that the price of admission to Dr. Wilson's house in the evening was a six-pack. That was all it took. And I'm not talking about iced tea. I could go on. I've already gone on too long. Simply put, I love my time here, and I'm grateful for it. My story tonight is really a Hillsdale story, in the best sense, because though I didn't know it at the time, my future vocation, including the founding of Image Journal, was already a seed germinating me within me when I left this place. My title tonight is Conservatism and the Arts, A Lover's Quarrel. I hope the subtitle says it all. Because while, in a sense, I walked away from the conservative movement, my whole career has been an extended dialogue with the tradition that nurtured me and for which I have an often embarrassed, frequently agonized, but always genuinely felt affection. Or maybe after you hear this talk, you'll just decide that I'm still trying to be a pain in the ass. One thing I do want to make clear, what I'm about to say is probably preaching to the choir for many of you here. All I can say is that A, this is my story, and B, you are all maybe a little closer to the movement than I am now. And maybe with these thoughts that we are going to share in common tonight, you're in a better position to go on to help to reform and renew it. So perhaps all I can do tonight is provide some encouragement for that important task. Now start by picturing me on November 4th, 1980. You remember that evening? Well, some of you do. It was the night of the election of Ronald Reagan to the presidency of the United States. I was fresh out of Hillsdale, and I was a glorified intern at National Review, which more or less meant being the receptionist and mail sorter. But it was Ronald Reagan's favorite publication. He did unpaid advertising for the magazine everywhere he went. It was probably violating federal laws, at least nowadays it would. But he plumped for this journal that he loved so much, and therefore it was the epicenter of conservative journalism in America. It was a moment of unparalleled triumph. The movement of which I had been a part even in my brief youthful time, a movement that had been operating in relative obscurity for decades, and which had been vilified by most of the leading intellectuals and cultural gatekeepers of the era, had won. And I was miserable. Not on the surface, maybe, I popped the cork with everyone else. But deep down, well, I guess I was going through my existential phase, Dad. I was unhappy. I wanted to get out of Dodge. And it's one of those ironies that the moment which I should have been waiting for and longing for so much was a moment when I felt uncomfortable and alienated. I sensed, I think, in an inchoate way, the narrowing effect that the quest for political power has on conservatism or any other branch of political philosophy. For the first time, I think, in those days, I realized with a shudder that conservatism itself could be the one thing that I thought conservatism was dead set against, an ideology. It didn't help, of course, that I had to answer the phones after the election at National Review with people saying, hey, can you tell me the difference between a G4 and a G5 federal pay scale? And by the way, are there any openings in the Department of Education? And I looked at the phone and I said, isn't our official position that we should abolish the Department of Education? The kind of time-serving ambition, the kind of flocking of these guys to the very trough that they had so powerfully criticized when they were on the outside really shook me in a way. Even then, in this inchoate sense, I think I began to experience the tragic dimension of politics. That gaining and holding power do terrible things to ideals and principles. I was prepared for it thanks to my Hillsdale education. I had read, thanks to Dr. King, Shakespeare's famous historical tetralogy, Richard II, Henry IV, Parts 1 and 2, and Henry V. And I could see that Prince Hal, this wonderful, lighthearted man of the world, who hung out with Falstaff and the whole panoply of down-and-out but life-giving, lower-class London, had to morph in a way that was really chilling and shocking for those who'd followed each of the plays into Henry V, the king, who then denies and banishes Falstaff to become like his father, the Machiavellian Bolingbroke. It's a moment in Shakespeare that's really quite chilling, and it's a sobering moment. And so in a sense, as I began to sense the trade-offs that exist between philosophy and ideas and the liberal arts and the actual nature of political power, it was a moment of a real education. And I don't mean to suggest any kind of ivory tower looking down on the nature of politics. I just mean to suggest that reality involves a recognition of that exchange, of that tension, of that balance. And that was really the first time I had to contemplate it, aside from slogans, aside from the sheer adrenaline of the victory of the presidential election. I was then, as I still am in many ways, trying to synthesize politics and art, and it's hard. It's hard to do that. It's hard to do that honestly and do justice to both. I felt, I don't know if Hillsdale was trying to do this consciously to me or not, but I felt and maybe wanted myself to become a culture warrior. Like most young men, I loved war. I wanted to be a knight. I wanted to fight. I wanted to tilt against all kinds of things. And I thought that my role was going to be as a kind of witty man about culture. At one point, I might even have been tempted to try to put on a bow tie and get onto Fox News. But I recognized pretty soon that my skills were not in that direction. I was irretrievably a literary person. I was the only thing I was good at was literature. And maybe to some extent, by kissing cousin relationship, understanding and caring about the other art forms. So my compromise goal about that time of Reagan's election was that at least I could become a kind of Christopher Hitchens of the right. Right? I mean, I thought to myself, that's a kind of hip, sophisticated, cosmopolitan culture warrior, right? I'd knock back a few G&Ts and go on, I'd quote Orwell, and I'd devastate somebody. I had read about T.S. Eliot in the early 20th century writing these wonderfully conservative essays that would have such an effect on Bloomsburyites like Virginia Woolf that she would read them and then stay in bed for a week with a headache. So I thought to myself, I would write devastating book reviews of novels by secular liberals, giving authors like Jonathan Franzen migraines that would last for days on end. I tried, and I failed. I don't mean that I couldn't actually do it. I simply discovered that I didn't have the heart for it. It was kind of a shock. I'm a pretty sturdy guy. I'm pretty goal-oriented. As Suzanne and I joked this afternoon, I write the outlines. She plunges in. I thought I had written an outline for my life. I'm a kind of workhorse. I'm not a thoroughbred. So for me, this moment occurring a few years after leaving Hillsdale was pretty much tantamount to a kind of nervous vocational breakdown. I couldn't do it. I thought the whole idea of doing the Zorro slash was going to be so much fun, and it just got boring. It got old. It got lame. I didn't have the guts or the desire. In retrospect, I see now that what I thought was a nervous breakdown was really a nervous breakthrough. I still believed at that point, and I still do, in the definition of conservatism given by my mentor, Russell Kirk, who wrote, "The conservative is concerned, first of all, with the regeneration of the spirit and character, with the perennial problem of the inner order of the soul, the restoration of the ethical understanding, and the religious sanction upon which any life worth living is founded. This is conservatism at its highest." Now you know why they called him a political, lightweight who couldn't get real power because he was talking about the inner order of the soul. But I thought he was right, and that one should stick by that intuition. So I didn't know what to do with this vocational crisis at first. I knew that I wanted to exercise the same skills. It wasn't about what I'd learned to do, write, edit, publish. It was how I was going to use those skills. In fact, in retrospect, I now know that the turning point started here at Hillsdale. It happened in particular through my encounter with T.S. Eliot. I took a course with Russell Kirk on Eliot. When I first encountered Eliot, I was in that super dweeby stage in which I came across his famous manifesto, which I think he later came to regret deeply stating because it just was too bald and too unnuanced and silly. But at one point, Eliot said, "In aesthetics, I am a classicist." Now, you have to realize in the early 20th century when Romanticism was still totally hot, right, to say you were a classicist was the equivalent to saying, like, I have a pole up my bum and I'm just going to walk around like that forever. It was the epitome of repression and squareness, even in the 1920s. And then his second point was, in religion, I am an Anglo-Catholic. And I was thinking, oh, well, Anglo-Catholic, that sounds nice. And I was discovering sacraments and liturgy, and I thought, oh, very nice. And then comes the kicker. This American expatriate says, and in politics, I am a monarchist. And I thought, yes, monarchy! Yeah, God save the queen. Like, you can't get more conservative as a young American than saying, like, democracy, screw that. By the way, don't ever be ashamed of your youthful foolishness. Don't ever be ashamed of it. In time, you will see it as a gift from God. Well, okay, so here I was. Eliot, he was given Virginia Woolf headaches. He was the model for the culture warrior proto-Hitchens that I was going to be. Cool. Oh, I better read his poetry. Forgot about that. The actual creative writing stuff that he did. So I was reading his poetry, reading his poetry. Wasteland, Drunchen, Ash Wednesday, and whatever. And then I'm like, there's one of those cognitive dissonance things going on in the back of your mind. Because, you know, I had grown up like many conservatives of my era, and it was like modern art and modernity were phrases that we used as bad, bad juju. And we talked about, you know, we talk about modern art. And, oh man, that was bad. That was, modern art was about chaos, disorder, sex, the occult, sex, and sex. And then I said, holy crap, this is what this guy's writing about. And he's writing in this fragmented style. It's very modern. How, you know, this does not compute steam out of the ears, right? I realize this, for most of you guys, this might be kind of like, duh. But for me, it was the linchpin. For me, it was that moment, that jujitsu moment, where my center of gravity and my, you know, and my motion in space flipped me over. And I thought, so you can be traditional in theology and political philosophy and so on and so forth, and you can be modern in style and form. Woo! And I thought, actually, that's kind of cool. Because it means that you don't have to kind of pretend to write in some other era's style, which, while you might actually be able to mimic it okay, would more or less end up feeling lame and kind of like, why not just go back and read Elizabeth Barrett Browning, you know? So it was a big moment for me. And it was a moment where I began to see, and then I thought, oh, Flannery O'Connor, wait, existentialism, alienation, violence, grotesque, cool. Walker Percy, oh, wait a minute, existentialism, French weirdness, modern scientific semantics and semiotics, cool. And I thought, wait, art changes over time. It's supposed to change even, like it's good that it changes. I mean, here's a thought experiment. So imagine you're like a bunch of Romanesque architects. You're sitting there and somebody says, you gotta come see this new church. So you all Romanesque architects, you're standing in this new church, Saint-Denis, I don't know, one of those things. And you're sitting there and you're like, oh, I'm blind! There's all these tall windows and pointy arches. I mean, you spent your whole life building the beautiful rounded arch, the symbol of eternity, the tie to the Roman Empire. And here come these whippersnappers coming in with their pointy little arches and their blinding light. God exists in darkness and mystery. Who the hell do they think they are? Those damn gothic newbies. Again, I know it's kind of a duh thing, but for me it was important. It was important to understand that form changes and needs to change. That's the nature of our life. Because why? Because we are fallen, limited creatures. Because beautiful styles get hackneyed. We do the best we can for a couple decades and then it doesn't work too well anymore. Because it's been done, been there but done that. And so style and form that change don't necessarily mean that content changes. In fact, it could be that the hunger, the longing, the desire to find the new form could in fact be the way to preserve the content, the meaning, the tradition. No less a conservative than Edmund Burke himself was quoted as saying, "A state without the means of some change is without the means of its conservation. Without such means, it might even risk the loss of that part of the Constitution which it wished most religiously to preserve." The two principles of conservation and correction operated strongly, and he says, and during the Restoration, the Revolution. Anyway, could go on. But it was that insight that really opened me up. And I thought, to be a defender of these ancient Western things, including centrally the faith, didn't necessarily mean defending one style or an outmoded style. It also meant engaging with the life of my time. And I, you know, Russell Kirk was there both a kind of paradox as well as an example. Because Russell Kirk would go around saying things like, I don't read anything since Walter Scott. As you might recall, was an early 19th century novelist. But what did Russell Kirk actually do as a young man? He hung out with Eliot. He hung out with that wild modernist Wyndham Lewis, with Roy Campbell, that crazy guy who took a swing at Stephen Spender. He went to London. He went and spent time with these writers who had deeply conservative instincts and were willing in very creative ways. Wyndham Lewis was a brilliant satirist. His book, The Apes of God, that did give Virginia Woolf a migraine for a week because it's a satire of Bloomsbury. And that was the practice of Kirk that I wanted to do that. I thought, you were in touch with, I want to be in touch with the life of my times. I love the classics, but I want to connect the present to the past. And of course, Eliot's argument in Tradition and Individual Talent is, if you don't connect with the present, you lose the past. If you don't connect with the present as a way of extending the tradition becomes false. It becomes skewed. We lose that sense of the living connection to it. So I thought, this is what I want to do. I also felt at that moment that the very language that had dominated the rhetoric of this movement I had been part of seemed suddenly to my ear so polemical, so full of apologetics in theology, and polemics in political argumentation, and rationalism, utilitarianism, pragmatism. Let's get elected. And I know we have to do that, and I don't begrudge that, but it so dominated things that I thought something was being lost. I felt, where is the imagination that Russell Kirk kept talking about, the moral imagination? Where is the love of beauty? For me, beauty became crucial. I know it's a word that we can define in many ways, and we fall back on our cliche that it's on the eyes of the beholder. That's bull duty in my opinion, but that's a whole nother lecture. What I think I began to realize was so important about beauty was that beauty is disinterested. Beauty is one of the few things that doesn't come at us with an agenda. John Keats once said, "We hate poetry that has a palpable design upon us." My wife always changes that to a palpitating design on us. And we know when a work of art has an agenda, when it's an agenda we don't agree with, because that's when we get it. We usually cheer on with the agendas that we already believe in, but we notice that and we reject it. Beauty, I think, in its purest form, doesn't have an agenda. It feels gratuitous and liberating. The Swiss theologian Hans Urs von Balthasar once said that because of our fallen condition, we always tend to argue over definitions of the true and the good. It's just in the nature of things. We're fighting over those things because we're fallen, we don't get it, and we always have an agenda. We come into those debates always loaded for bear. But he says beauty has the chance to come in underneath our radar, to fly under the radar of our interests and pierce us with a tiny beam from the beatific vision itself. At Hillsdale, we talk about liberty a great deal, but perhaps not often about the connection between beauty and liberty. If liberty means anything, it has to mean a space in which we are free from interests, agendas. So the beginnings of a vocation began to emerge. I felt more and more that artists are like pearl divers. They go down to great depths, and sometimes at great risk, in order to find these glimpses of beauty and bring them back to the surface that restore our sense of meaning. And that seemed to me in a strange way, and I don't mean to romanticize or deify them, but it seemed to me that there was an analogy, a resonance between the artist and the saint or the mystic. Because they too are pearl divers. They too dive down deep. The questions that faith asks drive us deep down into ourselves, to the mysteries of grace that are fleeting and elusive. So I felt drawn to these two forms of human dialogue and encounter. It seemed to me that in the long term, political debate is informed by the narratives and symbols that arise from deeper sources. I think I was arguing for this before the catchphrase, "the culture is upstream from politics," was ever uttered. That's the cliche, but I think at the heart of it is something deeply true. The things that get to the political arena are already shaped by the stories and the symbols that are the common currency of our life together as a culture. And if we're not shaping and deepening and making more true those narratives and those images, then by the time it gets to politics, the game is already lost. We need to make those things richer and more mysterious and more laden with meaning. May not help the politicians debate them, but maybe it will make them a little less likely to reduce them to ciphers and to slogans. The other thing I ended up feeling was that culture is better and best changed over time, not by just critiquing culture. Long before Andy Crouch wrote his book Culture Making, I had this instinct that the way to change culture is to create new culture, better culture. The way to change culture is to put new, good culture into circulation. It'll change the ecosystem much faster than 1,000 think tanks and 1,000 critical papers, and even Christopher Hitchens' like devastating book reviews. And so weirdly, it was like, hello, is this me? I said, I want to build rather than tear down. OMG! Oh, I'm so lame. But my soul was voting. My feet were moving in this direction. I thought, the critical voice, the analytical voice, that's dominates the conversation. We're always at a remove. We're always talking, yep, yep, yep. This is what this novel was good or bad for. How often do we actually read the novel, read the poem, listen to the song? There's always this huge barrier of talk, talk, talk. The creative voice was getting lost. I thought, what if we made that the priority for a while? The new criterion's not going anywhere. They're going to be around. Weekly Standard, all that, New Republic, they're not going anywhere, but could there be a place for people who care about these weird ancient religious things to just let that creative voice speak in its own way? I'm not saying that there's no place for that kind of analytical critical thought. I just felt that was the imbalance that needed balancing. And I've always been a little contrary, as you probably figured out, but I felt like if that was the imbalance, we had an obligation to work in that realm and then try to find where it eventually came to an equilibrium. So I thought to myself, eventually, who are the new Eliots, Percys, and O'Connors? There have got to be. And yet, when I went to my conservative brethren and sisteren to say, hey, what if we did a journal that was looking for the new Eliots, O'Connors, and Percys? And they're like, good luck with that, buddy. That's all in the past. What do you mean, what's in the past? Oh, Christian culture, you know, that died. Well, Percy is dead now, and that's it. What? It's like, good, you know, go for it if you want. I didn't get a lot of encouragement. But out of this came the ferment. Out of this ferment came the idea for Image. A place where we could let the creative voice speak. Fiction, poetry, creative nonfiction, interviews, memoirs. And I was mulling this over, thinking, should I do this? Should I not do this? And I was in a bookstore in rural Virginia, very horsey, Tony country, just passing through. I didn't live there. And I looked in the bookshelf of poetry, and I came across two collections. Paul Mariani's Timing Devices, and Andrew Hudgens' Saints and Strangers. And I was one of those places, like, you remember Augustine, he was on the verge, should I convert, should I not? And then he hears the child's voice, you know, take it and read. The trajectory, it was just two books, but they were brand new releases. They were in a random bookstore in Tony Horsey country. I thought, that's a trajectory, that's enough. That's it, I'm gonna do this thing. So thank you, Andrew. Thank you, Paul, and all those who came since. The instinct we had at that point was to make a big tent. Ideologues like to preach to the choir. It's the best way to raise money. It's not necessarily the best way to meet your brothers and sisters in the world, your neighbors. We thought, if we publish writers who are more churched, more creed-saying, and we put them alongside people who are full of doubt, angst, maybe anger, maybe resentment. The church screwed them as kids. But they were at least wrestling with it. Their anger was honest anger, honestly come by, and shared passionately with a love of beauty, with the form that they were making. What kind of conversation would that make? I thought that might be cool. We decided we were not going to publish a journal for those whose philosophies matched our own. In the end, that kind of seemed like more of the same boring old you know what. We published no mission statement. We didn't do what so many people have done to beauty and imagination over the generations, try to make it subservient to goodness and truth or some other agenda. If the philosophers were right, and truth, goodness, and beauty are each direct pathways to knowing the world, then the attempt to make beauty serve truth or goodness directly is a way of saying it can't do it on its own, it has to serve one of these other means. And that makes it servile. If beauty and imagination aren't ways to apprehend reality directly through their own methodologies, then they're second rate and they're servile. What if we took seriously beauty as one of the equal transcendentals to goodness and to truth? What if beyond reason and faith and reason, those two beautiful old workhorses, we added faith, reason, and imagination? What if that was the new trinity? This has been the problem with beauty and imagination. People over history have tried to make them subservient to other values. They're scared. Truth and goodness seem like righteousness and solidity of being. Beauty is like, woo, it could just take you away. It could scare you. It could like whisk your soul away. And you might end up in this world of sensuality and luxury, right? We've been afraid. Plato had some issues. I mean, he loved beauty. He loved, and he, you know, but he was conflicted. And we've inherited that conflict. We also thought, you know, another concomitant of these other decisions is image should hang up its shingle on the public square. We should not go back into the fortress of the movement or the religious subculture, of which there are many. We should go, we should join AWP, we should join, you know, all the various creative writing organizations. We should go to the conferences. We should publish work. The journal should be able to sit on the same shelf next to the Paris Review and the New Yorker. Not just publish our friends, but publish the best. What if we made excellence the criterion? So we used to say aesthetics before God. But it was an important moment for us because it was not about precisely ideology. It was about respecting art itself. All right. I'm out of time. Let me just say that I want to talk about the four temptations of conservatism. They're ones I'm not trying to accuse you of. And I think, by and large, the kind of community you have with your English department really helps you with this. So, and again, this may be, as I may end up ironically preaching to the choir when I've just denounced doing that sort of thing. But this is my story, and it was started at Hillsdale. So here are my four temptations of conservatism. First one is what I call declinism. It's a very deep temptation to believe that everything's downhill. And not only is it downhill, but we are as far downhill as we've ever been. And you find, you know, you find that that is very appealing. It also helps raise money to say this is the worst it's ever been, and we're putting our fingers in the dike, etc. But you know, it's been bad many times over the course of history. And there are frankly a few things. I mean, how would you graph Western Civ if you really had to do it? Like 1300 top and then look straight line down? I mean, honestly. Honestly, what do you really think? You know, you get into that declinist mentality, it's hard to shake it. I mean, even someone who I revere, like Richard Weaver, who wrote Ideas Have Consequences, denounced jazz. I mean, jazz is like what conservatives should love most of all things. I mean, it is the most beautiful way of balancing order and liberty, right? That's what jazz is. You have the order of the chords, and then you have improvisation. And I, you know, and the musicians know much more about it than I do. So you get embarrassing things like that. You get those Romanesque architects going, damn those Gothic architects. Don't give in to declinism. Second problem, Gnosticism. I know we talk about Gnosticism as if we're never guilty of it. But one of the things that I realized was that conservatism is prey to the notion, when it starts talking about modernity, right, that the world that we live in is so tainted that nothing good can come out through it without having the taint. Hence the skepticism about whether any contemporary art could be good art. It's been tainted by modernity. That's just wrong. It's like believing that the Holy Spirit is locked in a cage in somebody's basement, right? If the alternative to declinism is hope, the alternative to Gnosticism is humanism. Or if that's a scary word for you and that really is another lecture, incarnationalism. It's messy, it's public, it's communitarian. It's the world. Another thing conservatives have a hard time with is ambiguity. Conservatives want things to be singular. We want to believe in our country. There are a lot of eagles around here, I've noticed. A few more eagles than when I was here. I'm getting eagle phobia now. It's like twitchy. You know, ambiguity is what literature teaches you, is the fundamental way that literature works. And it's hinting to the fact that however beautiful our moral and theological principles are, that putting them in practice in the real world, in real world circumstances, is not quite as easy as just reciting the commandments. And ambiguity is a way of saying there are more than one possibility in this moment, in this image, in this dramatic situation. Ambiguity, in my opinion, is deeply conservative value, because to recognize that ambiguity is the nature of our experience is to suddenly be reminded of the need for humility. And I think conservatism at its best is a kind of humility. We think, you know, that the state or even the big corporations or big labor, whoever, can fix everything for us. That's wrong. That's hubris, the notion of the big major, you know, entity doing things. Better if we do it locally. Better if we do it with 1,000,000,000 local decisions of people dealing with the issues than from above, right? That's the essence of conservatism in so many ways. Ambiguity is a reminder of that. It's not our enemy. Ambiguity is a conservative value to recognize that it's deeply important to the nature of how we understand the world. So that's the third issue. Ambiguity rather than a kind of narrow singularity that is false, that is monolithic, that forgets that we are fallen creatures and that even our best values are sometimes compromised by our own incapacity, our own inconsistency, our own inability to live up to those ideals. And then finally, I would say the conservative temptation, fourth conservative temptation is the temptation to war. And not just for young kids, although the young love war above all things. And I think, and yes, I came to bring a sword. I recognize there's warrant for that metaphor in scripture. Here's another thing where I think my point is there's an imbalance and we need to work on that imbalance. It's time that we think that peace is a worthy goal, that working for peace is itself a conservative goal. One of the things I came to realize about the great tradition of literary humanism is that it's based on a sense of rhetoric as language that connects people, that seeks to find connection between broken and disparate parts and bring unity. And so for me, that's what art does. It offers us this space, this disinterested space, where we might be able to meet and experience one another. And you know how it's easy to write a flame email campaign or Twitter campaign against some a-hole who's you hate, but if you actually stumbled in the room in front of you, it's like, hey, how's it going? Hey, that's a nice dress you got on there. It's time that we learn that working for peace is not a lame option, that working for connection, that reaching out beyond the fortress, beyond the movement is our duty, is our call. At least the guy that I follow theologically most seemed to want to do it all the time. And I think he's kind of cool. So, 25 years of Image. You're very kind, all those who have been celebrating and making this time possible. The truth is, it may be a bad time, but there are those who are out there who are genuinely grappling with faith, grappling with the perennial questions. In 25 years of Image, I've discovered that the artists and the writers are actually out there. Annie Dillard, Kathleen Norris, Marilyn Robinson, Cormac McCarthy, Wendell Berry, Mary Carr, Christian Wyman, Ron Hanson, Richard Rodriguez, Jeffrey Hill, Anne Lamott, I could go on and on. We are not bereft. We are not without artists who are deeply grappling with the traditions that we care about. Think about classical music. Who are the four of the top 10 bestsellers in classical music? The composers of sacred music, Arvo Pärt, John Tavener, Henrik Gorecki, James McMillan. These guys are like poster child for classical music. They actually put posters of them in the very few classical music stories that exist anymore. Think about popular music. U2, Over the Rhine, Leonard Cohen, Nick Cave, Sufjan Stevens, Joe Henry, Sam Phillips, Bruce Coburn. I could go on. These are people who explore faith as a mystery, not as an agenda or a platform. Think about filmmakers like Wim Wenders, Terrence Malick. If I had to sum up what I learned from this journey, and I know it may sound like a cliche, but it's risking cliche is something you gotta do. Sometimes when you seek, you find. Take this a bit further. Sometimes when you seek, you bump into others who are seeking too. Who knew? None of this means that somehow we don't have urgent problems, that we aren't beset by deep and agonizing social, moral, and political dilemmas. We are. But what it does mean is that we have more resources to address those problems than we sometimes are led to believe. So I'd like to conclude, big sigh of relief, with a great quote from one of those great Christian humanists of the present moment, Annie Dillard, one that I believe I can endorse and still remain a faithful son of my alma mater. She asks, aren't our times special? Aren't they the worst ever? She responds with words of deep wisdom and encouragement, and I quote, there were no formerly heroic times, and there was no formerly pure generation. There is no one here but us chickens, and so it has always been. A people busy and powerful, knowledgeable, ambivalent, important, fearful, and self-aware. A people who scheme, promote, deceive, and conquer, who pray for their loved ones and long to flee misery and skip death. It is a weakening and discoloring idea that rustic people knew God personally once upon a time, or even knew selflessness or courage or literature, but that it is too late for us. In fact, the absolute is available to everyone in every age. There never was a more holy age than ours, and never a less. There is no less holiness at this time as you are reading this, hearing this, than there was the day the Red Sea parted, or the day in the 30th year, in the fourth month, on the fifth day of the month, as Ezekiel was a captive by the river Shebar, when the heavens opened and he saw visions of God. In any instant, the sacred may wipe you with its finger. In any instant, the bush may flare. Your feet may rise, or you may see a bunch of souls in a tree. In any instant, you may avail yourself of the power to love your enemies, to accept failure, slander, or the grief of loss, to endure torture. Purity's time is always now. Amen, and thank you.